It was a very cold morning on the dairy farm that day, about 10 degrees below zero. Yeah, it was cold. We had just let some fresh heifers into the main herd, which was a challenge in itself because they had never been milked before and their udders were really small. I was just out of high school and tired of working at Sonic. So when I saw an ad for a female dairy herd maid near Coffeyville, Kansas, I had jumped at the chance. This was exactly what I had wanted to do because I love being on a farm. Now, to help you understand, the milk parlor was designed to prevent the cows from kicking you in the head. The cows would run up a ramp onto a raised concrete platform and stop in front of a movable grain trough. All of this was about 4 feet off the main floor. Then there was this long piece of sheet metal that ran parallel to the concrete floor, and it was secured with screws on some pipe. Okay, back to the cows. Okay, this was a really cold day now, folks. I had some of the cows run in and noticed that I could not see the udder of one of the cows. I got all the other cows going and then I proceeded to try to feel around for the udder on what I assumed was a fresh heifer. Keep in mind, I have sheet metal. I'm reaching underneath, can't see what I'm doing. I just remember thinking, boy, this girl is really long-legged. I can't even find her udder. Impulsively, I stuck my head under the sheet metal to see where I could hook the milker. And this is where I got my two surprises. Pause there. Now, as a child, I had the good fortune to have grandparents that lived on a farm near a little spot in the road called Bartlett in Kansas. The highlight of my summer and the best memories I ever had were on that farm. In fact, some of my earliest memories were of the old dairy barn behind the house that was surrounded by colorful hollyhocks and wild roses. No one can explain it to you, but for those of us who are familiar with dairy barns, know that one of the best smells on the farm is the dairy barn, besides the recycled grass. I remember walking in on chilly mornings and being met with the whir of the milking machines, the warmth of the pot-belly wood stove in the center of the room, and the mixed scent of sweet feed, milk, and bleach. The rhythm of the milkers and the radio playing Hank Williams in the background could almost rock you to sleep. Now, my Uncle Vernon, an old bachelor, he moved back to the farm when I was a teenager to run the dairy, and he named all his cows beautiful Hollywood names, like Betty and Esther and Dolly and Clara. We never knew what to think about Vernon. He never married, by the way. My mornings were met with the sound of the farm report on the local KGGF radio station, the smell of biscuits baking and bacon popping, and the hiss of the old coffee pot. Granddad was always up before the sun and never ate anything less than biscuits with thick white gravy, bacon and eggs and coffee, liberally sweetened with overflowing tablespoons of sugar. By the way, he lived to be 99. And then he said he did not want to see 100 and just went to sleep. First thing each morning, Vernon would carry in a bucket of fresh milk, still warm and straight from the cow faucet. Other than a little speck of dirt and some cow hair, it was wonderful. Grandma did skim off the dirt, and she would blow the cream away while she was pouring it into the pitcher. So after high school, when I had the chance to work on a dairy farm in Coffeyville, I got the job on the spot. And I started immediately. The dairy was much larger than my grandparents' little 30-cow operation, and the equipment was state-of-the-art automatic milkers. The owner wanted to hire a woman because the man had beat the cows so bad they didn't want to come to the barn anymore. And when they did, their milk production was down. Therefore, my first challenge was to get the cows comfortable with coming back to the barn. I found out real quick that the pasture was huge, and where the cows were kept, I'd have to chase them around all day. It would take a long time to bring them in. There were 155 head of Holsteins and 4 Guernseys to add just a little butter fat to that milk. I whistled a lot anyway, so I decided to try one particular whistle every time I went out to get the herd. Slowly but surely, one and then another would start to come up to the barn. Within about 3 weeks, they were all coming up to the barn, and all I had to do was stand at the door and whistle, and I will not demonstrate it because it is very frightening. Ask my husband. The winter that year was particularly harsh, with below zero temperatures, frigid wind, and freezing rain. The cows would slip and fall on the hard ground, and sometimes we would have to use a front-end loader to raise them up onto their feet again. No one ever said milking cows was glamorous or easy. And then came that very cold morning with that long-legged fresh heifer and her two surprises. You might have guessed the first, because she wasn't a heifer and she wasn't even a sheep, but rather a young steer that had jumped the fence. That much was clear. The second surprise came at the exact moment of my revelation of the first surprise. A huge, hot pile of green, gritty manure on my head. It was. Normally I wore a ball cap. For some reason that day I did not. And I will let you know that that mass of green grass and sunshine was hot. Like third degree hot. In a rush, I grabbed the water hose and tried to get the green mess that was the consistency of wet sand out of my long hair. I got part of it out, but what remained was equal to smelly hair gel. The other factor that I had not considered was the fact that it was 10 degrees below zero. Well, I still had to go outside. I had to blade the lot and feed calves. Well, needless to say, my hair froze solid, not flat on my head, but particularly, it was kind of standing up a little bit in weird shapes. And it was green and grainy. And of course, of all days, this is the day my boss decides to come in and notices something is amiss with my hair. We chat for a couple of minutes with him staring at my hair the whole time. He finally decides to leave, but then he turns to me and he said, "I should ask, but I don't think I will." And he walks out shaking his head. It took a couple of days, a good hard scrubbing, to get that gritty mess out of my hair so it wasn't so stiff any longer and not quite so fragrant. So what life lesson did I learn that day, you ask? Don't stick your head under a long-legged fresh heifer's tail to find her udder, because things may not be as they seem, and you might just get much more than you bargained for.